Welcome to Inspiring Women. This event has run for a couple of years now, so kind of ongoing. This is the next step of it, I guess. We have three speakers, a break in the middle, and if you have any questions or thoughts, or you just want to tell people you're here, tweet with the hashtag SUSU Inspiring Women. But other than that, have a really good evening. So we will start our evening with Lynne Parker. She is from Funny Women.
Well, the first disappointment of the evening is I'm not a comedian. Okay, so just to manage your expectations, I'm also probably about three times older than any of you, but I'm hoping that some of my life experience might be quite interesting. I actually didn't go to university. And I actually went to somewhere, I went to college when I was growing up. College was kind of equally prestigious. And I went to the London College of Fashion and I studied, as you can probably tell, I studied fashion journalism. That normally gets a laugh, but I went from there straight actually into fashion magazine. I worked running public relations agencies of my own, working for other people, all the way through getting married, getting divorced, having two children, all the things that we talk about now, juggling my life and trying somehow to keep it all together. And 14 years ago, I was mad enough to set up Funny Women. Funny Women was created because when I was working in PR, I had the misfortune to work with a very misogynistic comedy promoter. He was my client. And night after night, I was going into the club to promote shows, and I never saw any women. Well, it was like one out of five shows a week, maybe they booked one woman on a bill. And I just asked him, I said, well, why aren't you booking any women? He said, well, women aren't funny, and there aren't any funny women. And that just made my blood really boil. So I said, okay, I'll throw you a challenge. I would like to put on an all-female comedy event. And he said, okay, then be it on your own head, you organize it. So that's how Funny Women was born. Now, in the midst of all this, he decided, the guy that I was dealing with, he had come over from America, and he and his British partner fell out, and the guy that hired me hightailed it back to the States. And the British partner took one look at me, I was in my mid-40s, and I was a female, and he said, we don't need you, and he fired me. So something in that whole experience made me think, I'm just not gonna let this go. And I did that classic, write it in a letter, send yourself a letter in the post. I did a very smart thing, which I didn't know much about in those days. I registered the website. I registered funnywomen.com.co.uk and anything else I could get my hands on. And the company was born, and that was probably around the year 2000. But the challenge for me this year is that I'm going to be 60. My personal challenge, I'm not going to try and make it cool, because it will never be cool. But I do want, what I think is important is the dialogue between my generation and your generation, and to come back to where I started really, which is about tap anyone you know who's had a career and had an interesting life and find out how they did it. And that was kind of my reason for being here. So over the next few months until I hit the big 6-0, and I'm going to have a big party, I've decided. I just think I'm going to do as much as I can to represent all those other wonderful women, including Gina Davis, who's my absolute idol. She's 60 this year as well, so I think that is pretty cool. And I'm doing a lot of stuff around, I'm writing about it, I'm at the WOW Festival, at the South Bank, I'm on a panel about women and ageing. And I would really be interested if, when I hang around later, if you've got any views on that and what you think of it. And do tell me if you think it's really don't tell me if it's uncool to promote it, because I'm going to do it anyway. But so that's my challenge for this year. So I think on that note, I shall leave you to your next speaker. Thank you very much.
Okay, so my name is Emma, and as explained, I'm a television producer. And this, by the way, I think is such a brilliant event. I can't help, we were talking about this earlier, I really wished that when I was at university, somebody, anybody actually said to me, you know what you could be doing? You could be doing television producing as an actual job. And instead I went into law. I did law and French because, well, kind of my dad did it and I was just deeply unimaginative to think of anything other than that to do. And also I wanted to do English literature and all my parents and my family said, that's not a real degree, you just love being bookish and reading and you know, that's, you're not gonna make money out of that. Anyway, I love that I'm very firmly back in that place now. But so in fact on my first day at university doing law, a barrister came to chat to us and he stood up in front of us all and there's about 300 of us in the audience in the amphitheatre and he said, he told us the kind of realities of barristers in the UK and the kind of earning potential and the success rates. And I was just wondering in my head, how do I get out of this? Because this is really not what I want to do. It's going to be such a big mistake. So anyway, I didn't. I stuck with it. I thought, you know what, I'm going to stick with it. I really liked the school of thought that comes with law, but I did. I found it just desperately boring, and I couldn't really understand how my dad had done it for so long. But that was fine. That was his choice, not mine. So when I finished, I went to go and train in Paris. As a lawyer. Anyway, so I threw myself in and it was absolutely terrifying. Not only A, because I felt blind, deaf, dumb, I didn't know what the hell was going on, even though I was pretty decent at French at that point, but it was like classroom French. I didn't have to really push the boundaries and kind of learn more than I needed to. So I got to Paris and I was suddenly catapulted into this very male-dominated environment whereby all the partners at the firm I was working with were men. Has anyone come across a French director called Luc Besson? So I was so excited. This guy was like a hero. And I was doing all the conveyancing, buying up his studios in Paris and whatever else. And when it came to the actual day of signing, I went down to the kind of big reception room. And the partners, even though I'd been working on it for 8 months, I did all the translation, all the work, they asked me if I would go make coffee and pour the champagne. And I was outraged. So I was like, F you bunch of leaks, I'm gonna go and do something else. And actually, I found that, you know, by doing all the research into what Luc Besson was actually doing in the studios, it opened up this whole new world to me that I just didn't know existed. And I met, completely by chance encounter, I met a producer who was over in Ireland filming. And he turned out to be this producer who had made one of my favourite films ever, which is called My Girl. So anyway, we got on very well, and he said, right, once you finish your exams, come work with me. And so I did. He came back to make another film in Ireland, and I was his assistant. And I just worked at everything I could. Just during the day, I was his assistant, and that was everything from like, dry cleaning to meet and greeting the, you know, the actors and their agents when they came to set, all that kind of stuff, but also reading scripts, and I couldn't get enough. I was reading scripts like 50 a week. I went back to him and I said, you've got to read this. I'm only giving you one this week, you've got to read it. He didn't. He came back upset, hadn't read it. Anyway, then I eventually left it in his hotel room with a big post-it saying, do not come to set until you've read this script. Anyway, it was living with sunshine. And that went on and got made, and it was very exciting. At that time, TV wasn't as cool as it is now. Like, you know, TV drama, this whole revolution, and, you know, it's almost like it's not the poorer cousin anymore. So I went to work at the BBC, and I went and got a job. I just thought, I would take anything. You know, the BBC, I was like, this girl from Dublin, the BBC was, I was starstruck just by the building. And this is all the same girl that passed out when giving a debate speech in Asia. So you can imagine what my interview was like. Anyway, amazing, I got the job and started working in the big shiny floor entertainment, so Strictly Come Dancing, I saw Matt Maria, all those really, really fun shows and mental as well. There's nothing like being live from a television studio and everything that can possibly go wrong usually does, but you learn really quickly. Anyway, then I moved on and I worked within the BBC, I worked every Saturday, every Sunday, just on other people's productions, just for free, just to get any experience I could. Then a contact I met at the BBC, who I did a lot of work with, ran as the creative director of Lime. And Lime is a company that runs Hollyoaks. And he said, oh, will you come along? And there's somebody, head of splits, is on maternity leave. And you know, I think this would be really good for you because I know you want to get into drama and this is the perfect way. And I just thought, to be completely honest, I was a bit like, Hollyoaks? Kind of shite. well, it was at the time. I'm not saying it's right now. He was like, it doesn't matter how you feel about the show, it's a 5-night-a-week show. There is nothing that runs in that much volume all year round, the world over. You'd be working on one of the biggest shows going. So I took the job. And it was, again, utterly terrifying. And it was a baptism of fire. I've never worked, and I probably will never work as much as you do on a soap opera. But holy shit, sorry. really blowing hard. If anyone wants to go into TV, I swear to God, my biggest piece of advice is don't be snobby about soap operas. They are, to put those things on TV, and the UK does them better than anywhere else, it is extraordinary. And it's such it's just such a furnace, you know, you just can't help but get melded into this world. But it's the most extraordinary thing, because now I can turn down projects. I can also turn down actors or producers or people that I don't want to work with anymore because I just don't think they're good people. And I don't think they are creative and generous. And I don't have many rules in life, but that's one thing I really, really will stick by. You know, I know that who was it? Madeleine Albright once said, there's a special place reserved in hell for those who don't support other women.
Good evening, and it's a real privilege to be here. I speak at a number of women's events at KPMG, talking about my background and my career. But it's a real privilege to see you at the sort of cutting edge of thinking about what your career is going to lie ahead for you. And my fellow speakers, I wish I'd had this opportunity when I was at university. I was born and brought up in Southampton, but I am in fact half Polish. My father came here having been brought up on a farm in Poland near the Russian border. He was taken into Russia at the beginning of the Second World War, worked in a gulag for just over a year, and actually whenever things get tough for me, I think about what my father had to go through, and that gives me renewed energy. And at the end of the war, he came to the UK. He literally missed the boat to go and settle in Canada because he'd had a heavy night drinking the night before. And so the rest is history in that he settled in the UK. He did have a trade, he was a tailor, and he met my mum here in Shirley, and she was a tailoress, or I should say tailor nowadays. And they settled down and had me and my sister. So I went to Taunton's here. I was in the building that's now actually owned by the university, by the Little Common. I was very interested in science and maths. And so I got my A-levels here and then went to read chemistry at Imperial. Now I didn't choose Southampton, not because Southampton wasn't a great university then as it is now, but simply because then you did what you could to get away from home. And I just fancied 3 years in London and I had an absolute blast. So I really enjoyed Imperial. But towards the end of my time there, I thought to myself, I really don't know what to do. And then there was one thing that I went to at Imperial, and that was one of the big four firms, not KPMG, came and did a business game. And my team happened to win the business game, and we all got given a bottle of champagne. I've never had a bottle of champagne in my life, and I thought, this is the career for me. They then took us to a nightclub that evening, and that was it. And I was going to sign up to be a chartered accountant. you might say, well, what does KPMG actually do, apart from audit and tax? There's very little, actually, that you can think about that affects business and commerce that we don't actually do. So one of the things that I want to really talk about is confidence. Now, I think everyone can suffer from a lack of confidence, but I think in particular, there's something about women and confidence that really resonates. I don't know whether you've heard of imposter syndrome. The imposter syndrome is that feeling, and some of you may have had it. When I first went up to Imperial, I had it, that everyone else here has got an entitlement to be here, and somehow I've managed to scrape the A-level grades that I did,
And one day someone's going to find me out because I'm going to start failing things and that sort of thing. And interestingly, the more successful the woman is, the more likely they are to have imposter syndrome. So it's just an interesting thing. Resilience is so important because all of us in our lives have had knockbacks. You've heard some of my fellow, you know, Emma and Lynne here, and I certainly have had knockbacks. And you will, sadly, all at some point in your lives, you maybe have experienced some already. And it's not about the knockback, and Lynne's absolutely right, you can learn more from the mistakes that you make than from things that go well. But it's how you respond to that. And I think Bill Clinton said that he went through stages in his career, getting signs saying my time's up, times in his career where you just have to show up. You just have to show up. So even if you feel all those voices in your head are saying things are going wrong for you and that sort of thing, just show up, just go through the motions for a minute and you will get stronger and actually get through it. Juggling work with family is a key part of this. You just have to keep going and just do the best that you can. I don't believe it is possible to have it all. I think I've come very close. I love my life. I love this work-life merge and the fact that, you know, I come home, I do a bit with the kids like I have this evening, and then I go out and do something else for work. That is part of what makes me me. If you're not sure what you're good at, then get a few trusted friends to tell you what you're good at. And then look for things like that, because you're in work for an awful long time, and so you've got to make sure it's something that inspires you and makes you happy.